If I fall asleep during my own address tonight, that's because I've just got back in this morning at 6 a.m. from the Kenyan-Somalian border. And what I saw, having seen many disasters, was pretty horrifying. It is unlike a tsunami or an earthquake, which is so dramatic and fills our TV screens and draws out our empathy because we go, that could have been me. That's awful. Donor governments leap into action. Publics around the world, certainly here in Australia, because in terms of private giving, we are up there as number one per capita private giving when there's a disaster, which makes me much more proud than the number of Olympic gold we win, or lots of other measures that you would think is the definition of an Australian. What's difficult, of course, about this disaster is it's a slow tsunami. Rains that have failed now for 3 years. And because we keep warning back in November, there's 4.5 million people affected. In March, we were saying there's now 8 million people affected. Because we didn't act, it's now 13 million people affected. It's difficult to get the world's attention, to get even the donor public, or usually so magnificently generous, to take it seriously. They say, well, maybe the rain will come. And we've got our own troubles here, and they're our friends, and they're used to pain and death and infant mortality. Can I say that an African mother feels exactly the same grief when her child dies as in an Australian mother? This idea that somehow they're used to it, and it's a different quality of grief, just isn't right. What drives human history, and I'm sure you'll reflect on this with your own parents and grandparents, is the engine of parents who will make the most incredible sacrifices to their own loss just so their kids might get a better chance. That actually is the great energy zone in history. And again, where I've been, you see that. Parents who are feeling the moral panic that they're failing their children. Because when the rains don't come, and the plants die, and the crops die, and the goats die, then their children start dying. And now this drought that's touched four countries, Djibouti, Somalia, which is particularly bad because it hasn't had governance, it's got a Shabab, Taliban-style movement that's making food distribution really insecure. But it's a drought that's hit Kenya and Uganda, creeping even into Tanzania. It's just enormous in terms of its impact. So, having been there, seen the suffering, World Vision responding, literally trucking in millions of litres of water and sorghum and maize. Sorghum, our main food stock for Africans, has gone up 250% in price. It's like a loaf of bread for us going from $3 to $7. And these are people who are living on less than a couple of dollars a day. So there's no chance of buying. And the dams have evaporated under the hottest sub-Saharan sun, the hottest sun in the world, actually, the sub-Saharan sun. And it is truly devastating. And to see these people and to try and raise your voice to say this is a huge humanitarian disaster when the world is obsessed with its own issues, debt ceilings, and credit downgrades in America and sovereign debt crises in Europe and London riots. It's actually really very, very devastating to come back and to feel the burden of that for people whose lives are hung in the balance. Of course, it's also an era which has bad government, and whilst that's not true now of all African countries, there's a number of African countries with a free press, regular elections, far greater transparency, not the accountability that we might wish for, far greater. But it still is the case that in some of these countries, the reason you go into politics is in order to become rich. No politicians, and I do know a few politicians, politicians in Australia go into politics to become rich. Whatever we might say about their perks, that's actually not where you can make really big money. That's different. in many of these countries. And so the legitimacy aspects of who you're there for and why you're there is profoundly disturbing. But that criticism is real, and corruption we take very, very seriously in World Vision. It is very serious. But when people's lives are on the line, it hasn't been their fault that governments have ignored them, and thus the importance of responding. Of course, in Australia, we appreciate the significance of droughts and flooding rains. We know that long, dry spells can create havoc and hardship, but there is a dramatic difference. We have resilience and safety nets, and we know that there won't be in this country a food shortage. Even if it's a short drought or a late rain,